Today we're going to explore a language with one of the oldest writing system, a language of one of the major religions, a language with probably the most complicated orthography rules. Tashi Dele. My name is Julie, and welcome to the Tibetan language. First, some official info. Tibetan is not just one language, but at least three. Central Tibetan, spoken by 1.2 million people, mostly in the Tibet Autonomous Region. Amdo Tibetan, spoken by 1.8 million people in Qinghai, Gansu and Sichuan provinces of China. And Kham Tibetan, spoken by 1.4 million people in Qinghai, Sichuan and Yunnan provinces of China. Those are languages that are actually called Tibetan. But there are also the Tibetic languages, over 50 distinct languages, including languages like Dzongkha in Bhutan, Sherpa in Nepal, or Ladakhi in India. All the Tibetic languages come from Old Tibetan, a language spoken in the 7th century, but only Amdo, Kham, and Tibetan, or Utsang, are still named Tibetan and associated with the Tibetan people. The Lhasa dialect of Central Tibetan is considered to be the standard Tibetan, which is also official in the Tibet Autonomous Region and the language of Tibetan media and education. But why are there three Tibetan languages? And what's their relation to the Old Tibetan? Tibetan belongs to the huge Sino-Tibetan language family, which is as old as the Indo-European family. The biggest member of this family are the various Chinese languages and dialects, but it doesn't mean that Tibetan is actually intelligible with Chinese. Their paths split 6,000 years ago, so they are as similar as English and Hindi are. They might have some interesting cognates in their basic vocabulary, but it's not really helpful. According to the most widespread theory, around 6,000 years ago, the Proto-Sino-Tibetans invented agriculture, which really boosted their population. They started spreading south and west. Those became Tibeto-Burmans. And those who remained in the original homeland, Yellow River Basin, became Chinese. Tibeto-Burman continued to diverge in an extremely varied landscape, from tropical rainforest, where we find languages like Burmese, to the highest mountains in the world, with Tibetic. The Tibetan plateau was inhabited for millennia, but the first centralized state, or even empire, was established by Song Tsen Gampo in the 7th century. He wanted Tibet to become a big player alongside China or India, and for that, he needed to tick out the checklist of the greatest empires club. A large territory, that's a tick. A centralized religion. After considering Chinese or Indian Buddhism, he went for the Indian version, probably influenced by his Nepalese wife. And a writing system. And since he already was sending scholars to India to study Buddhism, he also ordered them to bring the writing system from there as well. Why do the trip twice, after all? Song Tsen Gampo achieved his goal of making Tibet great, and great it was, as Tibet even defeated China in battles, and Song Tsen Gampo took a Chinese princess as his wife. However, after his death, Tibet slowly and painfully broke apart and entered an endless cycle of feudal struggle between various regional kings, so the Tibetan Empire was never great again. With the empire becoming more and more decentralized, Tibetic languages also started to diverge and break apart. But some other things remained and grew in importance. Tibetan Buddhism became a major influence in the region and was even at some point the main religion of the Mongol Empire. And still people all over the globe come to listen to Dalai Lama. And of course, the old or classical Tibetan remains the language of Tibetan Buddhism and the literary language of Tibet to this day. Another thing you can do today is joining my Patreon and vote for the next language and also see new videos before everybody else. Isn't that amazing? spoken Tibetan varies throughout regions. For example, Amdo is not even tonal, while Central and Kham's are. Central and Kham's are generally more similar to each other. It is said that they have 86% mutual intelligibility, though I don't know how on earth the linguist could come up with such a precise number. While Amdo versus the two others have around 75% mutual intelligibility, so Kham's and Central Tibetan speakers might even be able to understand each other, but usually won't understand an Amdo Tibetan speaker. Amdo preserved more features from the Old Tibetan. For example, Old Tibetan also didn't have tones. The written language, though, is the same for all of them and is based on Old Tibetan. Yes, that same language from when the writing system was created. It was adapted from the Gupta script in the 7th century by legendary minister Tonmi Sambota. The most mind-boggling thing is that since the creation of the script, the orthography hasn't changed much, making Tibetan the language with the oldest orthography rules. Imagine then how much the language changed since that time. So whatever is written, you can know for sure that would be read completely differently. This complication, though, has a benefit. Speakers of Tibetan are able to read ancient texts without much issues. Tibetan script was adapted from an Indian script. So like most of Indian scripts, it's an abugida. If you studied Tibetan for a long time, you could even start seeing glimpses of Devanagari. In Tibetan, there are 30 symbols for 30 consonants, which are organized into 7 groups with 4 consonants in each and 2 in the last. The letters in each group are organized with a mathematical precision. The first sound is unvocalized, ka. The second is unvocalized aspirated, ka. The third, vocalized, ga. And the last, nasalized, nga. This perfect math only works for the first 5 groups, though. I pronounce the sound a after the consonant sounds because each consonant inherently contains the a with it. To modify a vowel, we need to add a special symbol to get any of the additional 4 vowel sounds, ki, ku, ke, or ko. The last consonant in the 30 consonant list actually contains the vowel sound only, so is pronounced just a by default. I mean, if you ever encountered an abugida, this is all pretty straightforward for you, you know how it works. The complicated things begins when, for example, to say hello, tashi delek, which by the way means auspicious goodness, and that's an amazing way to greet people in my opinion. So to say tashi delek, you write bkra shis de legs. Yeah, that's what happens when you use a writing system from the 7th century. But to explain the logic behind this, first let's see how to form syllables in Tibetan. You see, the syllables in Indic languages have mostly a consonant plus vowel structure. There are consonant clusters, but they are not that prevalent. So an abugida, where each symbol is exactly a consonant plus vowel syllable, makes perfect sense to them. But Tibetan is all about consonant clusters, and it's not that uncommon to see a syllable structure like consonant plus consonant plus consonant plus vowel plus consonant plus consonant. To adequately represent that with an abugida, Tibetans invented smashing and stacking letters together on both horizontal and vertical planes, like crosswords. One syllable can contain up to 8 symbols. The prefix, which comes first, then the superscript on the top of the root letter, then the root letter itself, the subscript under it, and the vowel symbol under that. Then we move left, where we can put the suffix, then the second suffix, and finally a dot that marks the end of a syllable. So all that makes this complex syllable brgyuks. But that's all Tibetan. When we fast forward 14 centuries, we find that many things have merged and simplified. The prefix, the superscript, and the second suffix are not pronounced anymore. The subscript and the suffix may or may not be pronounced. Only the root kept its original pronunciation, though it also may be modified by the symbols around it. To compensate for this simplification, Tibetan has developed 2 tones, high and low. So in the alphabet table, the first two columns kept the same pronunciation, but got an innate high tone. The third column, from voiced and aspirated, became unvoiced aspirated and got a low tone. And the last column also got a low tone. So instead of brgyuks, we would now read gyuk. And by the way, all these pronunciation rules are true for Central Tibetan. Amdo and Kams will all read this thing differently. But let's now hear how modern-day Tibetans speak.
Kenla, tuji sin, kunjo khanda shik yue ba, sevu sungro na.
Du da karu mebe, ngundu ne. Pana ngubu mebe, ngundu ne. Lana mebe, kunjo kone yue. Kone nganju deju midubu.
Did you hear the difference between the three Tibetan languages? Personally, I'm not sure if I can distinguish Kham's and Central Tibetan, but Amdo does sound quite different, has more of the consonant clusters. What do you think? And while writing in the comments, let's pass to the next section. When Tonmi Sambhota traveled to India in the 7th century, he not only brought back a writing system for Tibetan, but he also described and systematized the Tibetan grammar. He wrote 8 treatises, out of which 2 remain, the 1st and the 6th. These treatises are structured in the way and tradition of Sanskrit grammar books. They are written in verses with a predefined syllable count. Their concept of grammar was not the same as we currently have in the West. Writing and pronunciation rules and grammar rules are all intertwined and are considered one thing. So, interestingly, the first written text in Tibetan is about how to write a text in Tibetan. These 2 surviving treatises are so crucial for the history of Tibetan language that the first syllables of their titles are combined to become sumtak, and this literally means grammar in Tibetan. Now let's see a simple phrase. Kon pepa re. He is Tibetan. Tibetan is an SOV language, the verb comes at the end. Now when we say pe la kon yodre, he is in Tibet, what happened here? First, Tibet is in oblique case, so it is marked by a particle la. And there are 6 cases in Tibetan in total, and the particle that you need to use for each case will depend on the sound at the end of a noun. Sometimes there are 4 options to pick from. Tibetan also has an ergative case, and I'm not gonna focus on it here, but I explain what is ergative in details in my Basque video, so check it out. About Basque, by the way, there is a theory that in some strange way, on a very distant level, Basque, Caucasus languages, Sino-Tibetan, Nadini, Murshaski, and Yeniseian all belong to the same macrofamily. So Tibetan, Basque, and Navajo could all be related. Again, you can find out more in my Basque and Navajo videos. Now, where was I? Oh yeah, the example sentence. You probably saw that instead of re, that means is, we used yodre in this phrase. The difference here is similar to the Spanish ser and estar. The first defines something constant, while the other defines a temporary state. But now we're gonna see the most unique feature of Tibetan. Watch that. Pela kon du. I saw that he is in Tibet. So what is happening here? Tibetan has a very sophisticated evidentiality system. In other words, it grammatically marks where does the information come from. So yodre means a well-established fact that is known for everyone. and Duk means that the speaker saw it with their own eyes. There are different degrees of confidence in the information that the speaker conveys. Either the speaker saw it or heard about it, but they're not sure. Maybe they come up with it by themselves and so on. And all of this is indicated in the grammar. Tibetan originally was a monosyllabic language, and it still is in some sense. But most of its words actually have more than one syllable. But that's because they are composed of smaller monosyllabic basic words. For example, mouth plus hand becomes food, fire plus tip becomes flower, tree plus tip becomes fruit. It is a very poetic way to form words, which in my opinion corresponds to the poetic and philosophic nature of the language itself. So there was my presentation of Tibetan, or more precisely of the three Tibetan languages, the Central Tibetan, the Standard Tibetan Cross Tibet, the center of Tibetan Buddhism, Amdo with its more conservative features and no tones, and Kham's with Kham people renowned for their extraordinary height. Kham men are on average 180 centimeters tall. I honestly didn't know where to put this random but rather curious fact, so I put it here and now you know. Thank you so much for watching and see you in our next exploration.